In listening to the people, I got a steady beat out there today, so it gives me a little rhythm for the press conference. And spent a good chunk of the day hearing from folks. We've got over 100,000 emails, obviously some for, some against, but spending some time. I don't get to read them all personally myself with that many, but have been a fair amount of time reading through those emails, hearing from contacts from people all across the state of Wisconsin. I'm here today working. I appreciate the fact that the state assembly is here in the Capitol debating the budget repair bill. I appreciate the fact that Senate Republicans are in the Capitol preparing to debate a number of measures and hoping to be able to debate the budget repair bill. It is my hope that later today we might get some updates from the 14 state senators who are not in the Capitol today, not doing their job, and that they might give us some sort of a time frame as to when they plan on coming back to do their job. I want to talk about a couple things in the budget repair bill, just a couple new things and then a couple things to clarify. First off, I think it's important to talk about the impact in this budget repair bill as it relates to the budget I'll introduce next week on March 1st. Clearly, I have said all along, and I think you'll see very vividly today, that this measure passing is critical to balancing the next state budget. And I'll give you some examples. We've announced today, you received copies of this, that this budget will provide local governments, this budget repair bill in anticipation of the budget, will provide local governments with nearly $1.5 billion of savings, $1.44 billion to be exact. I'll divide that out, that's for schools, just under $1 billion worth of savings, $976 million. For our municipalities, it's $196 million. For our counties, it's $128 million. For our technical school systems, that's $116 million. And for the other special districts throughout the state, it's $31 million. That's $1.5 billion worth of savings come from the measures included in this budget repair bill. That's real budget savings. And one thing I want to make abundantly clear today is those savings, the savings for local governments, will exceed the reductions in state aid that I will include in my budget presented to the members of the state legislature next week. Let me repeat that. The savings that are key, the savings that come only when we pass this budget repair bill for local governments will exceed the reductions in state aid that will be included in our budget bill for the next biennium next week. That's important because if you look across the country, governors all across the United States are talking about cutting billions of dollars from schools, from local governments, from other jurisdictions. Unlike, for example, in New York and California, where ironically there are Democrat governors making those cuts without giving schools and other governments the tools they need to balance them, what we're doing in this budget repair bill in anticipation of our budget is giving those local governments the tools they're going to need to balance their local budgets with the reality that we're going to see less in terms of state aid. In total, we have just over almost $1.75 billion worth of savings in this budget repair bill. It's the $300 million of savings in the next biennium we get from the changes that we propose in this bill for state employees, as well as the $1.44 billion worth of savings for local government. That's important. And for us to lock in that savings, to have that done in anticipation of the budget bill, we need one thing, and we need one thing in particular, and that is for those 14 state senators to come back to Wisconsin to debate this bill, to participate in democracy and allow us to move forward in the fact that they should be doing the job that they were ultimately elected to do. Secondly, this bill is about jobs. For us, the alternative is if we do not see this bill pass, we've already mentioned that for this year alone, for fiscal year 2011, that ends June 30th, the total number of jobs that we equated would be the equivalent of the $30 million we save by starting our wage and benefit reforms as of April 1st, is the equivalent of 1,500 jobs. As I mentioned the other morning in one of the local TV shows here in town, if we're not able to pass the bill by the end of the week, for us, that ultimately means at-risk notices will have to go out, and if ultimately that would affect 1,500 individuals. On top of that, if we don't achieve the savings that are generating this budget repair bill for debt restructuring by the end of the week, we lose out on about $165 million savings. And for us, we'd have to go to the next step and determine whether or not that indeed means that there'd have to be additional at-risk notices put out in terms of additional layoffs to make up those savings as well. So clearly that's a problem. Even more so looking ahead to in the future, because again, this budget repair bill and the savings achieved through it really set us up for what's going to happen in the next budget. The equivalent of savings we need at the state and the local level is 5,000 to 6,000 layoffs of state employees. An additional 5,000 to 6,000 local government employees would have to be laid off. That's 10,000 to 12,000 state and local government employees, government workers all across the state of Wisconsin. Now, I have great respect for our workers, both in the government and outside of government. And I think at a time while our 7.5% unemployment rate is still better than the national average, we can't afford to have anybody laid off. Adding to those numbers is unacceptable. But unfortunately, we'll have little or no other choice if those Senate Democrats continue to hold out from allowing the Senate to move forward on a vote on this measure. So again, dire consequences, but a way to get out of those dire consequences is for those 14 members, or at least some of those 14 members of the state Senate, to decide it's not worth holding out, staying out of state, to jeopardize the jobs of state and local workers. Third, and I just talked about, but workers, I want to make this clear, because this doesn't get a lot of coverage. We are asking all of our workers at the state level, we're asking workers at the state level and at the local level to make a sacrifice. All of us who are involved in this decision-making process, myself, my staff, my cabinet, the legislature, are going to make that same commitment in terms of making additional payments for pension and health care contributions. When I talk to people across the state who don't work in government, they think those are modest requests. They're modest requests for anybody outside of government. We understand, though, that to do this, there has to be some shared sacrifice. In return, however, what we're giving our workers to be mindful of not only job protection, because our bill is not filled with furloughs, it's not filled with massive layoffs. Our bill protects our workers in this state and at the local level. But it also gives them an option whether or not they want to participate in their union, and ultimately no longer by law mandates that their union dues have to be deducted from their paycheck. For some of our workers in the state, that's going to mean up to $1,000 that no longer is automatically forcibly taken out of their paycheck. Think about that. That's $1,000. In some households, that might be close to $2,000, depending on where those individuals work and if both in that household work there. That's real money. That's money that those households can use to help offset that pension contribution and the health care contribution. That's real money that helps the bottom line. And we're giving those employees the right to choose when it comes to having that money taken out of their paycheck, and ultimately that, the right to choose when it comes to being a part of the union. That's important because I think that's a benefit for our workers. Finally, it's not just about the budget now and into the future. It's not just about jobs or workers. This is ultimately about the future of our state. You see, it's bigger than just this budget adjustment bill. It's bigger than just the next biennial budget. For year after year after year, we've seen in this state, like so many other states across the country, politicians have made promises and failed to deliver on them. They push the tough decisions off to the future. Well, the future is now. And we want to make a commitment to the future to ensure that not only for ourselves, but more importantly for our children, they're not faced with the kind of dire consequences we face with this budget in the years in the future. We got to make sure that we deal with the problem now, not with a short-term fix. The reason we're in this problem, the reason we face a $3.6 billion deficit is because politicians in the past have deferred the tough decisions, and now it's time for us to stand up and do what I think our children will appreciate, and that is make the tough decisions. So, again, I just want to acknowledge that I appreciate the people who are here. Certainly appreciate those, even those protesters are here from Wisconsin. I welcome those in from other states, as long as they're here to inform the debate, to add to the debate, to inform it in a positive way in terms of offering opinions pro or con, but we certainly don't want individuals from outside of the state, particularly some of the national political leaders who are coming in from Washington and elsewhere, trying to interfere with the process of having this debate. And so I appreciate you all being here. With that, I'll take some questions. Jess?
Can you say at this point how the people of Wisconsin can trust that you're moving forward with this issue in good faith when there's a phone call recording of you out there discussing the possibility, or that you consider the possibility of bringing in agitators, or even the possibility of trying to trick Democrats into coming back for a vote?
Yeah, for us, I think it's real simple. First off, I want to say I take phone calls all the time. Took phone calls with small business owners earlier. This individual, I've taken phone calls from, actually I've talked to one of the Senate Democrats over the weekend, hoping that they might be interested in finding a way to come back. I've talked to individual taxpayers across the state. As I mentioned, last night, I've listened to people both pro and con in terms of the emails we received. But the bottom line is the things I've said are things I've said publicly all along. The fact of the matter is, people have brought up all sorts of different options. And as you saw, if you've listened to the tape, we put that down. We said we've had a civil discourse. My greatest fear over the weekend was that somehow when we had the abundance of people on either side of the issue, both for and against the bill, that that might somehow lead to a disturbance. For us, that doesn't benefit the debate. We've had a civil debate in Wisconsin. It is a very Midwestern trait. That's something, while others have brought that up as a consideration, and we've had all sorts of options brought to us by staff, by the lawmakers, by people from all across the state. But as you heard on the tape, we dismissed that and said that wasn't a good idea. In terms of other ways to come on in, it's not a trick. We've said it point blank. Come on in and talk about it. I'm willing to talk about it. But I ultimately believe it needs to lead to a vote. I don't think that's a trick. I think that's something I've said time and time again in front of all of you here and stated very frankly. Now, I'm not going to allow one prank phone call to be a distraction from the reality is that we have a job to do here. And the job is to debate this bill. And you're only able to debate it if you're in the Capitol, focused on what's at hand. Make your case, make your argument, but in the end, you can't make that by fleeing to some other state. Patrick, you had a question? I heard Patrick. What's that? I didn't. I absolutely didn't put that.
No.
We thought, what I said is, the question was asked, we thought about in terms of there's all sorts of options out there. I think you've not only seen in our actions, but you heard in my comment on that tape that I dismissed that. I said it was brought up to us. That was my acknowledgement that it was indeed brought up, as you can only imagine. All the different ideas that have been brought up. There have been ideas brought up along the way that people wanted me to point out the excesses with individual employees, with government workers all across the state that wanted me to somehow put the blame on them by pointing out the excesses of overtime or other issues, and I haven't. Because to me, this is not about the workers. This is about our future budget. Patrick, you had a question. Patrick?
How can we help? What can we do to help? Mm-hmm. And you talk about keeping the phone calls coming. We might not need ads for someone in particular, but we might need to get that message out down the line, mm-hmm. which sounds like advertising of some kind. Is it appropriate for you to be talking to third parties about campaign-style activity?
It's not campaign. What we're talking about right now, we've freely discussed. We've been talking to people all across the state who are interested in this issue. This isn't about a campaign. It's about getting the message out about the truth. It's why I hold press conferences with all of you every day. I don't hide in my office. I don't hide in another state. I'm here doing my job, pointing out the facts. And the facts are, we need to balance our budget. We point out the truth about it. I certainly hope, as I mentioned on that call, as I mentioned on plenty of calls, I hope if people look for things to do, the best two things they could do if they're for our cause is continue to contact lawmakers, particularly the state senators who are missing in action, but contact lawmakers on either side of the aisle to affirm the belief on the position they think they should move forward on, and then ultimately to help us get the message out, because there's a lot of distortions out there. There's a lot of misfacts and misstatements. The more union bosses come in from Washington, the greater the lies and the deceptions out there. But again, we're ultimately going to have this decision in this Capitol by the 132 people who were duly elected, Republican and Democrat alike, and myself will ultimately be the ones on behalf of the people of the state who have to make this decision. And my hope is we can continue to find ways to get that message out.
In this phone call, you drew a parallel between Ronald Reagan's actions against PATCO and said that that caused a change of history. You say that you could change history by this move. Mm-hmm. Does that not sound like union busting rather than budget balance?
No, it's 100%. If you look at the impact that President Reagan had back almost 30 years ago, nearly to the day, what he talked about was doing the right thing for the right reason at the right time. What we're doing right now is not about using busing, not at all. It's about balancing our budget. And the simple fact of the matter is, and I can tell you all this, having served more than 8 years as a county official, one of the biggest barriers to realistic flexibility for our local governments, and giving them the power to go ahead and avoid massive layoffs, to avoid furlough days, to avoid massive service cuts for the very people we elected to serve, is to give local governments the tools they need to balance their budgets. What I'm talking about today shows you that in this budget repair bill, we will provide local governments nearly $1.5 billion worth of savings. That is more than what will be cut from them. That's unlike nearly every other state across the country, where they're cutting billions of dollars from schools, from cities, from towns, from villages and counties, without giving them tools to match it. This is our moment. Our moment in time is the fact that for years, if not generations, political leaders in this state have failed to make the tough decision and instead have ignored the fact that this state increasingly has taken on costs that they can't afford. And for me, this is where it is a turning point. I grew up, let me finish, I grew up in the mid-1980s in a small town called Delvin. And back then we faced a very similar economic crisis to what we face today. From our standpoint, I look at that and remember at the time, Tommy Thompson was elected governor and he helped turn this state around. I know about all of you, but at least the people I talk around the state feel like I do, and that is I want my two sons to grow up in a state at least as great as the state that I grew up in, and I know, having local government experience in the past, that that will not happen. That will not continue unless we get these wage and benefit controls under control, because they're eating up more and more of our budgets and taking more and more away from the services, the critical services we were elected to provide in our schools, in our cities, our towns, and certainly our state government.
We've got time for one more question.
In this bill, there's a no contract bid for the public, and especially in reaction after this call, I think there's some people who think this is sort of payback.
Yep.
So I guess two parts. Would you explain why there needs to be a no contract bid for these power plants? And then what would you say to people who are saying that you're paying back one of your largest donors?
Right. Absolutely nothing to that. 100% wrong. Not that you're saying it, but that allegation out there. As I understand, I didn't hear about it personally, but through the media, those same folks have put out a statement saying they have no interest in these power plants. This idea goes all the way back to when I served in the state assembly. One of my former colleagues, Representative Mark Duff from New Berlin, as part of a program called Waste Watchers, pointed out the possibility of changing the state's ownership when it comes to power plants. It's an idea we resurrected as others brought those ideas up during the transition. And for us, we're going to have an open and accountable process so that everyone knows who's interested in that and what the process is. And we're only going to move forward on it. This only gives us the option on it. We're only going to move forward on this if it's good for the taxpayers and good ultimately for the ratepayers in this state. But it gives us one more tool to balance our budget without having to cut core services. Thanks very much for your time.